Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. Welcome to AVO's Electrical Training Today monthly webinar series. Today's topic is circuit breaker components and how they're operated. My name is Jamie Smith, and I'm the marketing manager for AVO Training Institute, and I'll be acting as the moderator for today's presentation and supporting you on any technical issues or questions for our presenter. On the right side of your screen, you will see a control panel that looks similar to this one. You can submit questions at any time during the presentation by typing in the box highlighted in red, and I will read those questions out during the Q&A segment at the end of the webinar. Just FYI, all webinar attendees are eligible to receive one NETA CTD and one PDH or 0.1 CEU just for attending today. You will receive this in an email within 2 to 3 business days of the webinar. And that's basically that email is just going to be a proof of attendance. You won't actually get like a certificate, but you can submit that email to whichever organization you're applying for credit. Also, that email will include a copy of the PowerPoint presentation and a link to the video recording of the webinar if you'd like to watch it again or share it with your colleagues. Remember, you can ask questions at any time during the presentation. Just be sure to submit those and they will be answered at the end of the webinar. And before we get started with the webinar, I just want to give you a quick update on what's new at AVO. If you haven't heard already, as of May 1st, we were finally awarded IASET accreditation. IASET stands for International Association for Continuing Education and Training. It took us a couple of years to get the accreditation. It's a very rigorous process, so we're very excited about that and excited to offer it to our students. But IASET developed the original continuing education unit, the CEU that you're probably aware of. What does it mean for AVO? It means our company has, first of all, gained a major competitive advantage that most electrical training companies are currently unable to provide by demonstrating our commitment to best practices and professional training through mastering that rigorous accreditation program. And what does it mean for our students that train here? It's really just proof that our training you receive through AVO is one of the highest quality. It's that your CEUs are transferable between cooperating organizations, and knowing that your employees or your coworkers are properly trained and remain safe day in and day out. So like I said, we're definitely excited about that and look forward to offering that to all of our students now. What else is new? We are now offering two newer courses that started this year. Those are microprocessor-based relay testing feeder protection and also microprocessor-based relay testing transformer protection. If you'd like more information on those courses, just let us know in the comments box of the survey and we'll be happy to send you more information on those. Also, we've added two new locations recently, training locations in the U.S. One is in Elgin, Illinois, about 30 minutes from Chicago at Circuit Breaker Sales. We also added one in Houston, Texas at Powell Electrical Systems. You can visit the drop-down locations menu on our website to view more information about those or view upcoming courses at those locations. And last but not least, AVO and the Megger family in Dallas will be moving into a new facility later this year. So we hope to be in there by the end of the year at the latest. It's just 6 miles north of our current facility, but it's twice the size and a lot nicer. So we have some great ideas to implement and just, you know, it's proof that we're growing and continuing to grow and provide better facilities for our employees and also for all of our students. All right, and let's go ahead and get to the presentation. Today we have our presenter is going to be Dean Bartlett, Senior Instructor for AVO Training Institute. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Thank you for joining us today, Dean.
Yeah, hey, thanks, Jamie. This will be my first webinar, and I'm excited to be here. When I was first asked to do this topic, I really wanted to do circuit breakers, but that topic can go in so many different directions. There's so many different styles, type, voltage levels of circuit breakers that it's a massive undertaking to just pick out any one topic to talk about. So I thought I would speak from my experience, which is from a utility background, who has a lot of different equipment different manufacturers, different voltage ratings, different type of operating mechanisms, and so forth. So first off, I want to give you a little bit of my background so that you'll understand kind of where I'm coming from. It'll be more of a field from the field experience than someone that's trying to lecture to you with no field experience whatsoever. So I have a utility background, which meant that, you know, I was on a substation crew, stayed there for about 7 years. A substation crew is responsible for commissioning, maintaining, testing, et cetera, on various types of electrical equipment. And we were working on equipment rated from 15 kV to 345 kV. Breakers obviously come in lower voltages than 15 kV, 480, 240, 120, a whole range of voltages, and even higher than 345. But in that time I was on the substation crew, it was 4 years of formal training, on-the-job training for anybody that was newly hired as a worker. And so the training was a progression of steps that you would take. And then at the end of the 4 years, you would have a position of senior substation. It was self-study, on-the-job training. And finally, after 4 years, I reached that level of senior substation technician, which is really the one thing that I learned as a technician, as a senior technician for sure, was that I really didn't know a lot. 4 years, 7 years. There's not really there's not a lot of time to gather in all the information that you'll be using to work on breakers and other switch gear. You might not see a particular breaker for 3 or 4 years. You might have never seen the breaker, period, if it's a new breaker. And so the technology changes, the test equipment changes, the safety regulations change. And so I really had to be honest with myself, I had a lot more to learn at the end of that 4 year period than I probably did learn during that 4 year period. So after some period of time, I was promoted to chief electrician. I stayed as a chief electrician for 3 years, who just performed more advanced testing on transformers and circuit breakers, the type of tests done with power factor test set, breaker analyzers, the more detailed testing, and that's where we really got to get in and start troubleshooting the breaker components, mechanism, operating mechanisms, and is really a learning growth for me during that time. So we also did CT and PT testing. And finally, before I left the utility, for 5 years, I was a relay technician, commissioning and testing protective relays that were associated with distribution, transmission, generation relays. And from that time on, after I left the utility, I started working for a company known as Multiamp Training Institute, which is now AVO Training Institute, back in, I guess it was the late, early 90s at that time, yes. And so I've been here ever since, and I'll have to say I've learned as much here as I did out in the field from the other instructors and the support that we have here from our group and from the Mega group. It's really been a great experience for me. So, my discussion today, and I picked this out intentionally because I wanted to talk about get the most for our buck. Talking about medium voltage breakers that are electrically operated, that can be racked in and out of a cell, in the switch gear. These type of breakers are typically more complex than fixed breakers or outdoor breakers, molded case breakers, air circuit breakers that are bolted in. Because you have to rack the breakers in and out. There's obviously some safety issues involved when you put somebody in front of a breaker with the door shut. Sometimes the door's open, racking that breaker out. There's some things that could go wrong. There's things that have gone wrong. There's PPE to address. And certainly the red flag should go up before you start racking the breaker out. That's when you're moving something within an energized area. That's the time that you want to stop and really think about what you're doing and what the procedure is going to be. So they can be moved in and out of the cell, which is going to put personnel in harm's way. It oftentimes will, especially if your company has not done the arc flash study using the correct PPE, which I'm sorry to say that's where we were at when I worked for utility. We didn't have the luxury and the advantage of using PPE that you have on the market today. So the injuries and the accidents are obviously hopefully not as much as they were back in the day. So the manufacturer has to provide safety measures, such as interlocks that protect personnel for various situations that you find yourself in. The interlocks have to interface with the breaker when the breaker's moved in and out of the cell. There's certain things that you don't want to happen. There's certain things that you do want to happen. But obviously, if the manufacturer can come up with a way to prevent that or minimize it, then that's what they're going to be required to do according to standards. So the manufacturer's methods of doing that continue to change. If it's a breaker that you've not ever seen before and you want to rack it out or rack it in as a new as commissioning the breaker, you certainly want to sit down and look at the manufacturer's instruction manual. In fact, that's the first page. On the first page, they'll tell you that you need to read the entire instruction manual prior to working on this type of equipment. OSHA requires it. Understanding the hazards involved, how the construction of the equipment is. So it's really they've really driven safety home on the manufacturing of breakers, but then that also complicates things in how the breakers are functioned to do that, both mechanically and electrically. So again, you should always review the method, discuss it with your group, have a tail board, everybody get on board as to what's going on when you rack the breaker in and out, type of PPE you need to wear, who's going to be in the area. Are you going to use an automatic or a robot to rack the thing out? That's always a good option, but not everybody has that luxury. So there are things that can happen. Okay, so talking about the circuit breaker operating mechanism, when you talk about something of this magnitude, you have to understand that to be good at it, to get a clear understanding, you need to know how the breaker works mechanically as well as electrically. Without knowing how it functions mechanically, there's really no way that you'll ever be able to interpret a line diagram or a schematic of a circuit breaker if you don't understand how it operates. So mechanically, if the breaker has limit switches, if it has auxiliary contacts, if it has a motor, you want to know where those are located. You want to know what they do, when they do it, why they do it, and what goes wrong when they don't do it. And know it just like you would a garage door opener. You know, the door goes up, the door goes down, it stops limit switches. There's a motor that causes that to happen. Breaker mechanisms basically are about the same thing. Know what it's doing mechanically. If you don't have electrical background, that's what I would suggest that you do is sit down and read the manufacturer's instruction book. They'll go through the operating principles, the description of the breaker, its application, its specifications. But then when they get to the mechanical and electrical operation, they will break it down for you and discuss both of them. They'll discuss mechanically and electrically how the breaker operates. But here's some things to keep in mind. And some of these might surprise you, or maybe things that you didn't know, or maybe things that you suddenly go, well, hey, that makes sense. Now, things to keep in mind when you're working on a circuit breaker operating mechanism, some things that happen, some things that they do or they don't do. Okay, so basically there's two functions that the mechanism is doing, the operating mechanism is going to be doing for the breaker. It's going to provide the energies needed to operate the contacts. And most often for this type of breaker, it's a spring charged with a motor and a gear mechanism, a ratcheting mechanism. But there's also breakers out there that still are in service that work off of pneumatic systems, an air system, work off a hydraulic system. There's even those that operate off of they will close with a huge solenoid, you know, big around as a football. That's the older, excuse me, that's the older style, but they're still out there. Are they doing anything different? No, they're really not. They're opening and closing a set of contacts. Once they have that control power or that method of doing so. And so in these type breakers, it's going to charge up a spring that could be compressing it, that could be stretching it, but somehow get the energy you need to open and close the contacts, which takes in the opening about 2 to 3 cycles, and for closing it's about 3 to 5 cycles. So they're very fast to operate. And if they're not fast to operate, then you've got a problem. But and here's a picture of a BCPW mechanism, and you can see it has two sets of springs on it. It's got the closing springs on the left side. If I can get my pen right, closing springs here, opening springs here. So that mechanism is going to have to charge up the closing spring, and then when the breaker does go closed, it will stretch the opening spring. There is no opening spring motor. There's only a closing spring motor. It's generally a heavier spring, and you could have two opening or closing springs on the same breaker. Larger breakers would have. So everything that you see then is tied to this common shaft that goes all the way across and operates the breaker. Let's look at some more things to keep in mind. Two springs operate the breaker. The closing springs stretched or compressed with a ratcheting mechanism. The opening springs are charged each time the circuit breaker closes its contacts. Once the closing spring is charged, it's electrically disconnected. That would be done through a motor cutoff switch, a limit switch, like on your dryer door, like on your refrigerator door. It simply opens up the circuit and lets the motor come to a stop. Mechanically, the motor stops with the close latch. The close latch is going to catch a roller as the spring is stretched. It will catch the roller, and you'll even hear it sometimes make a snapping sound. So when the spring's charged manually, you will hear that sound. You may ratchet it 30 times. You might ratchet it two or three times. But in the end, when the spring goes to the charge and position, you're going to hear that snapping sound, which is the closing latch catching a roller to prevent the spring from discharging. The mechanism does not rotate in two different directions. It doesn't go back and forth. It continues to rotate in one direction. I'm talking about the main shaft of the mechanism. Now, the contacts go close and open, but the mechanism itself continues to rotate only in one direction, 360 degrees, a complete circle, and then it'll do it again. Each time it rotates, it moves 180 degrees. The mechanism will, when you see that mechanism turning, it's going to go 180 degrees, and the next time it turns, it's going to go another 180 degrees. So it doesn't have any interim, any mid position. If it does, then it stopped for the wrong reason. So the mechanism, it'll charge a spring, and then 180 degrees, if you release that spring, the contacts go closed, and it starts back over again. We'll see that in a minute in some artwork that I have. Okay, so each time the mechanism rotates, it's either charging the spring or it's closing the breaker, one or the other. It's either charging the spring or it's closing the breaker. It doesn't trip the breaker. The breakers trip when the mechanism collapses. When you see the mechanism turning, it's either turning very fast to close the contact or it's charging the spring and turning fairly slow. The spring is normally charged every time it is discharged when the contacts go closed. Now, that's something that your ear, you'll pick that up with your ear. Every time you hear the breaker close, you generally hear the spring charging up. Okay, but that's not necessarily 100% of the time. There are breakers out there that will charge a spring only when the breaker is open. Square D does that on their low voltage breakers, and there's options to do it on medium voltage breakers. And the only thing that's different about that particular breaker would be that they put a B contact in the motor circuit so that the B contacts open when the breaker's closed, closes when the breaker opens, and it allows the spring to only charge if the breaker's open. So if you ran into one like that, your ear would pick it up. First thing you say, well, that didn't sound right. It didn't sound like a regular breaker, because breakers normally charge the spring every time it closes. Okay, but it can be made to charge the spring to charge when it's open, and you definitely would know it. Okay, to close the circuit breaker, you have the breaker is closed by moving the close latch. It's held by a roller. It can be released manually with a push button or electrically. All I need to do is allow that roller and the close latch to disengage, and the mechanism is going to roll 180 degrees. It's a large cam that forces the roller out of onto the outer edge that moves the middle phase. The middle phase is the one that's actually moving. The other two phases are going to be tied with the middle face. When the contacts go closed, they're held closed with the trip latch and a separate roller or some sort of latching mechanism like a trip latch and a half shaft. So that doesn't sound, I guess I didn't understand that first time somebody told me the breaker's held closed with the trip latch. But that's true. The trip latch is all that holds the breaker closed. And if the trip latch is not in place when the breaker is closed, it's not going to close. It's going to collapse back in on itself. It would act as though it's trip free. That's what trip free, or one way to look at trip free, is that the trip latch is not in place to catch the breaker, and it simply lets the mechanism collapse. Sometimes that's intentional, sometimes it's not. Okay, so normally the contacts would remain closed till the trip latch is operated manually or electrically, manually from a push button, electrically from using a coil. Now here's this is that's the VCPW breaker, but I have an animation or a drawing that I've done that shows a typical breaker mechanism. Now some of you may recognize it. You say, well, it looks like a low voltage DS type breaker, and yes, it does. It also is the same type of mechanism that Westinghouse would have used, Squared would use on a medium voltage vacuum breaker. It would just be turned on its side. It would look, it'd be situated a little differently. So the mechanism that we're talking about, the shaft I'm talking about, everything that rolls in a complete circle is turning on this shaft right here. Okay. You have to look at this and say, well, if I'm looking at this particular drawing, I can see that the contacts are open because this middle phase is leaning back and it would have a pivot point here that would allow it to close. It's obviously the breaker's open. But how do I know the spring is charged? This is directly from a manufacturer's drawing, and they would have it labeled this way. Breaker's open, spring is charged. Okay, the spring is charged. I can see that it's charged because it, right here it's stretched as far as they can stretch it right here at this pivot point. In other words, as the shaft turned in a counterclockwise direction, it pulled this lever out. And now we need to stop it before we release it. We want to store that energy, and we do that by, as this closing cam turns around, that roller sits right behind that latch right there. That's the closed latch. That's what you hear snapping when you manually charge a spring. It could look a little different on different breakers, but basically that's what's going to happen. We're going to stop that spring from turning manually or mechanically with the latch and roller. The motor would be kicked out. The certain motor circuit would be stopped with some sort of motor cutoff contact. So the wiring from this motor would go to DC negative on one side. This side would have simply something labeled motor cutoff contact or limit switch, motor limit switch. They may call it a B switch, B contact, or a limit switch A contact. Depending on the manufacturer, how they label it. They may not even label this motor as a motor. They may call that device 88, a circle with the number 88 in it. That's an IEEE number. Or they may just call it M. But the motor, I need to know what that motor does. And it continues to run until you open up this cutoff switch. And each time it rotates one revolution, it hits this ratcheting device and advances this tooth one tooth at a time. It advances that ratchet wheel one tooth at a time. The pause here will keep it from falling backwards, keep it from going back the opposite direction, because you're providing spring tension as you're starting to ratchet this thing around. So it has a tendency to want to fall back and go the opposite direction. So we keep it from doing so with pause. So it's kind of like a come along that you might have. So it's rotating in a counterclockwise direction. The motor will run until this shaft has turned 180 degrees. And that's when it'll stop it. The spring will be fully charged. And now all we have to do is discharge the spring by using a solenoid and apply enough energy at the end of that latch to make it operate and move the roller. Let the roller pass in front of it. And that's when the breaker would go close. And when it closes, everything's moving 180 degrees. That roller, this latch is going to end up over here. This spring's going to end up over here where it's completely relaxed. Everything's going to turn 180 degrees when you close the breaker. Okay, so I, electrically or with a push button, I'm going to move that close latch and let that breaker go close. If it's slow or sluggish or it doesn't seem to close with any authority, it's probably a lubrication problem. Simply too much of the wrong stuff or not enough of the good stuff when you grease the breaker or when it was lubricated. Okay. If it never charges the spring at all, it's probably in the motor or in the motor circuit, maybe the limit switch in the motor circuit. So that's basically how the spring is charged. Shaft turns counterclockwise. The motor advances the ratchet wheel one tooth at a time. Holding pawls keep the wheel from turning backwards. When the spring is charged, a limit switch electrically opens up the motor circuit, and the closed latch and and roller stops the shaft mechanically. So again, I need to know mechanically what this thing is doing, and then electrically, I need to understand how they're doing it. And it's a very simple circuit in the motor circuit. We'll see that in a minute, but simply from your positive fuses, they're going to bring that straight into the motor through some sort of limit switch or cutoff switch down to the motor, which again could be labeled M or could be ANSI device number 88. And here's my negative side right here. All I have to do when the breaker spring is discharged, that contact is closed. As soon as I apply control power, that motor should take off running. It'll run until the motor cutoff contact opens up. So the motor cutoff contact is going to be basically monitoring or looking at how far this roller has turned or how far the spring has stretched, just like a garage door. You open it up, you want to stop it. You don't want it to go up in the attic. So you have some sort of limit switch that will stop the motor. Let's move on. Okay, so we're going to then focus in on this boxed in area. If we understand what's happening out here, which is nothing more than a motor circuit with a limit switch. If we can understand that, how it charges and discharges spring, then we can forget about it. Okay, there's not a lot of problems going on with the motor circuit unless it burns up or it continues to freewheel. If it doesn't stop where it needs to stop, it'll just continue running. There's not a lot to look at. All of the actions happening right in here in this area that I've got highlighted with a red box. Okay, so this here it is again in, at the top left of the page. I'm showing the closed latch has caught this roller, so I know that the spring is charged. If you see any of the drawings where that roller is being stopped by a latch, you know the spring is charged. I know over here the spring is not charged. How do I know? Because this roller is not up against this latch over here. If it was, the spring would be charged, and that's what would stop the movement of the shaft. Okay, so to get from a breaker that's open and a charged spring, I can now close that breaker by releasing this latch, and very quickly the spring's going to discharge, and what's going to happen? This is going to rotate 180 degrees. It always moves 180 degrees. So if this rotates 180 degrees, look what happens to this roller right here that's in that detent. In that closing cam, it's going to be forced out onto the outer edge, and you see that over here. You see the roller has been pushed out of that detent, out onto the outer edge, and moving the mechanism up in this direction. A bell crank's going to translate that into horizontal motion, vertical to horizontal, semi-vertical to horizontal motion, called a bell crank. You probably heard that language before. Insulator right here, insulating the metal in my mechanism from the energized components of the current path. It's going to close the middle phase, and the other two are tied to it. So the breaker is then going to go close. Well, what keeps it from just falling back open? It's not a motor starter. A motor starter, if you were closing contact with a motor starter, you'd have to keep the coil energized. This is not a motor starter. It's a breaker that once you close it, you let the closed coil de-energize, you don't keep it picked up, and you let the breaker mechanically latch closed and stay there until you get ready to trip it. So here's the fun part. When the breaker closes, It would drop right straight back down like that. It would just fall right back open again. If this half shaft right here, and that's a half shaft, the end of it has been flattened out towards just a half shaft, something like this, you know, where it's been cut out. That's not a real good drawing. And that's what's catching the edge of that trip. This is the trip latch. Looks kind of like a three-cornered triangle, if you will. That's the trip latch. It's holding that. It's set underneath that half shaft, which forces this roller right here to be pulled up against the edge of that cam. I know it's getting messy, but stay with me. It's keeping this roller pulled against the flat of the cam, closing cam, and it cannot jump. It cannot drop down unless you move this roller over to the right just a little bit. That happens if you release that trip latch, and the trip latch is allowed to fly up like that, which will drop this point down and to the right. That's a constraining linkage. They use that in many, many breakers. Constraining linkage, if this end goes up, this end is going to come down and to the right, which is going to let that roller fall to the right or move to the right, and that's when the breaker would trip open. As long as you have that latch behind that half shaft, that's not going to happen. And that's the only thing that you imagine. It's the only thing keeping that breaker closed. It's just a little bit of engagement with this trip latch sitting behind that half shaft. So if anything was broken off here, or if the half shaft was out of position where it could not latch underneath that edge, the breaker would go trip free. That's what trip free means. If this trip latch is not there when the breaker closes, it's going to fall right back open. It's kind of like a pitcher throwing the ball and there's no catcher there. If he's not there to catch it, then the ball's going to go wherever. The same thing as the trip latch. It's got to be there in place to catch the trip latch to hold the breaker closed. If it doesn't, the breaker goes trip free. So why would that latch not be there? Well, it might not be there because I've got a lock in the breaker. I pushed the trip button, pulled the tab out here, and I put a lock in it. That would keep that half shaft out of position. If I push the trip button in, it moves that half shaft. But if I've got old, dirty, dry grease and the half shaft is out of position, that will cause the problem. Sometimes you want it to be trip free. You don't want the breaker to close, such as when you put a padlock in it. Sometimes you want it to close and it doesn't close. That's when the trip latch is out of position. Due to what? Due to grease or no grease or the wrong grease or too much of grease. Then the trip latch is not going to reset and the breaker is going to go trip free. So if you've ever had a breaker that wouldn't close, and we've all been there, it happens at what time? 2 a.m. in the morning, the breaker won't close. You go out there and hear stories all the time. We were out there half the night and then in, you know, till 10 o'clock the next morning. That should not happen. If the breaker won't close, it's the trip latch. It's the trip latch. I don't care if it's grease, interlocks hung up, the buttons pushed in, whatever it is, somebody cut it out with a saw. The trip latch is missing and the breaker's not going to close and stay latched. It's that simple. At least that's where I start. In other words, if I hear the motor charge a spring, if I hear the spring motor stop, if I know the spring is charged, and I close that breaker, electrically, manually, doesn't matter, and it goes trip-free, look for the trip latch. There's usually an adjustment. There's usually a means of inspecting it, making sure that it's in place. That's very important, very important. Okay, here, if I did successfully close the breaker, it closed because the spring discharged. The spring discharged. The breaker closed. How do I know the spring discharged? Because this roller's up here now. When I operated the close latch, that roller goes 180 degrees. Remember, it always turns 180 degrees. So it went from here up to there because everything's turning counterclockwise. Just the same as that detent, which was over here, moved 180 degrees to the opposite end, to the opposite side. So everything turned 180 degrees. And that's how I know the breaker is closed, but the spring right now is not charged back. It's discharged. The spring is discharged. If it was charged, it'd bring this back around another 180 degrees. Remember, this thing only turns if it's charging the spring or if it's closing the breaker. Charging the spring, closing the breaker. That's the only time that that thing is going to turn, and it's going to turn 180 degrees. So with the breaker closed, is there anything wrong with me having the breaker closed and spring discharged? No, there's people that operate in that mode. But if the breaker trips, I'll have to have the spring will have to recharge electrically or manually to close the breaker back. So operating with the breaker closed and spring discharged will not let you immediately reclose the breaker. You'll have to charge the spring back up. Okay, let me erase some stuff here just right quick because I want to show you what happens when you go from this position to the next position. With the breaker closed and the spring charged, the next thing I want to do is charge that spring up. So everything stays right where it is, and I'm going to go to the next slide and imagine this thing going counterclockwise. And what happens is that right there. It goes from here. The shaft is turning counterclockwise in this direction. It sets right. It didn't go far enough to drop that roller down. But notice everything went how far? 180 degrees. That roller ends up right there, 180 degrees. This detent ends up over here, 180 degrees. It moves 180 degrees to charge a spring. It moved 180 degrees to close the breaker. The breaker is now, actually that should be closed with the spring charge. That's my fault. The breaker is now closed with the spring charged. If it now opens, it would drop this roller back down into this detent. Why would it open? Because I've turned this half shaft. Here's the half shaft. Here's the latch. It's holding that latch. If I rotate that half shaft just a little bit, this latch is going to fly up. This is going to come over to the right, allowing the roller clearance to fall back down into that detent where the breaker would be open and the spring charged up, which is exactly where we started to begin with. We started in that position right there, breaker's open, spring is discharged, or spring is charged, and that's where we end up at. Pardon the mess. But that's what you want to be able to understand is how to go through the operation of the breaker and see what's happened mechanically and then how I might do this electrically. Okay, so the breaker, in order to do this thing electrically, there's four things that you're going to find that electrically do something on the breaker. Number one is the motor. The motor does something. It charges the spring. That's a device or a load that's in the breaker. The second thing it does is it closes the breaker. Now, the closed coil, which is what operates releases that latch, can be called many things. 52CC, 52 being the ANSI device number for AC circuit breaker, CC closed coil. SR, Westinghouse uses that, spring release coil. Simply CC without the 52. So there's different names that you'll hear that closed coil called, but they all do the same thing. They move the closed latch to dump the spring. So you'll have a motor, a closed coil, a trip coil, 52 TC, or just TC, not many other names they call the trip coil, the motor 88, forgot that one. And then you'll also have the fourth device would be a Y relay, anti-pump relay, 52Y, which is the relay that nobody seems to understand or has a difficult time understanding it. The fact of the matter is a breaker would operate just fine without that Y relay. In other words, I could go in and cut the wire of the coil off of your Y relay and you would never know I did that. Maybe for the next 40 years until you needed it. When you need it, you need it. But until you need it, it just doesn't do anything. Doesn't do a lot. Okay, so let's look at a breaker electrical drawing, schematic, diagram, whatever you want to call it, and see if we can't understand then how this thing is doing electrically what we want it to do mechanically. So the first thing that I will look at is to, is see where the motor, and it's usually the first circuit on the breaker diagram, be on the left. What does it take to make that motor charge up? Okay, let's start first with the wiring. We have positive at the top. Oops, don't go there. Don't go there yet. All right, we have positive at the top, negative at the bottom, and as soon as we put those fuses in, does that motor start? Well, I can see my external wiring is the dotted line. That's customer wiring. I bring it in on an auxiliary stab that's made inside the cell when the breaker's in the test position or connected position. So here's where it comes into the breaker through those arrows, and here's where it goes out of the breaker through this arrow. Okay, so it's coming into the breaker on two stabs, in and out, and right here they have a LSBB, LS1BB. Okay, they're looking at this as if it were a B contact of some sort. In other words, they didn't call it motor cutoff. They didn't call it just LS. They called it LS1BB. Okay, this B is very similar to this B over here. Okay, that's a B contact. It's an auxiliary contact. This is what they're referring to as a double B contact, but it's not an auxiliary contact. These A and B contacts that you see that are used in the circuit are operating off of the mechanism as it opens and closes. When a breaker opens and closes, see if I can do this a different way. Okay, when the breaker opens and closes, there's the contacts, here's a pivot point, here's a stationary contact that the breaker is going to close onto. Here's the stabs that go out the top of the breaker and the stabs that go out the bottom of the breaker. Okay, very simple in what I'm drawing. This would be the line side, this would be the load side of the breaker. As the breaker closes, as the contacts close or open, the linkage somehow, and then I'm going to animate it very, you know, this wouldn't work in real life, but I'm going to put a lever right there and a drum switch that rolls a bunch of contacts, several contacts stacked together, operate every time the mechanism operates. If the contact closes when the breaker closes, and keep in mind we got open and closed contacts in this drum switch. If it closes when the breaker closes, that's an A contact. So if over here in the circuit, if I see in my circuit a 52A contact, 52A, and it's open, then I know the breaker's open. It follows the breaker. Okay, any B contact that's on this same drum is going to be just the opposite of the breaker contact. So when the breaker's open, I would see a B contact over here that's closed. What would I use a B contact for? I'd use it to burn a green light. When the breaker's open, that 52B closes. So what I'm going to do with it, I'm going to put a green light, use that for my green light circuit. Okay, so A and B contacts move with the mechanism or move with the contact. A follows the mechanism, or the contact, B is just the opposite. Okay, so let me go back. This B contact, they're calling double B, is also shown in a closed position just like this one is. If I had a double A, which is right here, they show it to be open. Okay, let me do this then. Okay. Technical error. So y'all couldn't see some of that. So let me not try that again. Not sure where I lost you, but we'll just stay with our print right here. So you're saying they could see some of this, Jamie?
It sounds like a few people couldn't see what you were drawing.
I think I know when that happened, okay. When the screen, it kind of changed on my computer. Yeah, sorry about that. I'm assuming y'all can probably see this when I did a little jumped over here somewhere else. It didn't allow you guys to see what I was doing. Okay, so I'm simply saying that the fact they call these double B's and this a B, they're drawn closed. The A, this limit switch double A, is drawn open just like this A contact in the trip circuit is drawn, but they're not the same thing. The LS2 double A, the LS2 double B, those are contacts that are going to operate when the spring motor, when the spring changes position. So the double B contact here is drawn closed because the breaker spring is discharged. This one over here, LS2 double A, is drawn open because the spring is discharged. So these double A and double Bs are following the spring, movement of the spring, and the A and B contacts that are drawn over here in the control circuit are simply a drum switch that follows the mechanism. A follows it, is closed when it's, the breaker's closed, it's open when the breaker's open. So we can tell that this breaker is obviously drawn open since the A contacts are drawn open, and that's how the control diagram would be drawn. Okay, so I have a complete circuit to the motor. The motor would run and charge a spring up until this double B contact opened up and stopped the motor. But I've also got another contact in that motor circuit, they label PS2. Okay, that is a contact that's going to be operated for safety purposes. That contact would open if the breaker was in between the test and connected position. In other words, you can't see, they don't really tell me what that is. The legend, even if we were looking at the legend, doesn't tell you what it is. In so many words, it just says it's a auxiliary contact or a contact. So we're thinking, why would they put a contact in the motor circuit other than this limit switch that looks at the spring? They put it in there so that if the breaker's moving between test and connected, which is the point at which you're most likely to have an incident as you're racking the breaker into the cell, this opens up. Okay. At the same time, PS1 over here closes. All right, so this PS and this PS are operated from somewhere other than just a limit switch or an auxiliary contact. That's when you need to go find the manufacturer's description of how this breaker is operating. This one, so what we're saying is the breaker, you've seen this on the breaker. Here's the floor. Here's a little ramp inside on the floor. There's a roller of some sort hanging down underneath the breaker, okay? And as it reaches this ramp, it goes up onto that ramp, and then it drops back off as you continue to rack the breaker in. If you look at physically where the breaker was, here's the test position, and finally you get it into the cell in the connected position. In here is La La Land, Never Never Land. You do not want the breaker to operate while you are moving it. The shutters are opening. The breaker's fixing stab onto the bus, and here you are in front of it with a crank, racking it in. They're going to intentionally let this roller open up this motor contact here and then close this one. So why would they want to close that one? We'll explain that in just a minute. But we want to protect the worker while he's racking the breaker in. Don't let it even try to close or the spring to charge up with the breaker in between test and connected, because that's when you've got the most likely to have an accident if something did happen. The shutters don't open, the breaker goes closed for whatever reason. That's what we're trying to do, protect the worker. Okay, so they're doing it a little bit differently as far on the VCP breaker that may not look like a regular breaker that you've seen before. This contact here is also operated off the floor, sitting right beside the PS2 contacts, is this one here. As the roller rolls up onto that roller in Never Never Land, we're going to pick up the Y relay. Pick up the Y relay with this contact right here. That's going to put negative through that floor interlock, if you will, to the Y relay, pick it up, okay, pick it up or keep it, I'm sorry, If the breaker was closed, I'm sorry, that's when it would pick up and not let you close the breaker. So if anybody were to try to close the breaker outside of the breaker at the panel, the Y relay is immediately going to pick up, seal itself in, and open up that contact right there. That's what that is eventually going to do. It's going to open up the Y relay, which prevents the spring from discharge, spring release coil, closed coil. That is not a normal way to do things, but it is a design that they have in the VCPW breaker. Okay. Now let me go. Let me erase them. Instead of going to another board, let me just erase everything here. Okay. All right. So we're going to erase this and finish this scheme and hopefully have a better understanding of how these interact with the mechanical movement of the breaker. Okay. When you close the breaker, you simply, in a normal close, you want to energize the closed coil, spring release coil. You've already charged the spring. This one opens up and stops the motor. This other limit switch right here closes, and the latch check switch would be closed if the trip latch is in place. Okay, so now with this motor charge and this limit switch closed, latch check switch closed, you have a direct path to the close the breaker. Okay, now every time a breaker closes, here's what you want to know. Energize the Y relay. Every time the breaker closes, energize the Y relay. Now, how are you going to do that? There's two ways that you're going to energize this relay right here. You're either going to do it with a limit switch in the spring charging circuit, or you're going to do it with an A contact, an auxiliary contact. A lot of folks do it this way right here. This is the contact that's going to energize the Y relay. Because when the spring charged up, this one opened up and this one closed. Okay, so with the spring charged up, when you release the spring energy to close the breaker, the spring dumps and this one comes back closed. That's initially what picks up the Y relay. As soon as you close it, the spring, the limit switch here picks up the Y relay, seals it in through its own contact. Right now, this one does nothing. It's not in play. You're picking up the Y relay with a motor cutoff switch and sealing it in. The Y relay now opens a closed circuit and will not let the breaker close the second time. So remember this over here. Pick up the Y relay every time the breaker closes, and as long as you have a closed signal on the breaker, it will not close the second time. The latch check switch here, what's it doing? It's seeing if the hind catcher is there ready to catch the ball. That's looking at the trip latch to see if it's in place. If not, I'm going to leave this contact open, and you can't close the breaker. And then, of course, I would call this contact here a permissive contact. Every breaker will have that. If it has a spring charging motor in the closed circuit, they're going to put a limit switch that tells you when the spring is charged. In fact, they also put a white light up here to tell you when the spring is charged up. That's an option that you always have. So this one has a limit switch here, a limit switch here, a limit switch here, three limit switches that they're using. Sometimes manufacturer just has one, but every contact in this scheme has a particular job. Okay, this is a little bit complicated in how they do this for safety, opening up the contact with the Y relay. Otherwise, you'll always have a B contact. Its job is to de-energize the closed coil. You'll always have A contact, maybe two, de-energizes the trip coil. This contact burns the green light. This contact over here in the motor circuit stops the motor when the spring is charged. Those are the functions that every breaker will have. Charge a spring with a motor. Once the spring is charged, tell that to the closed circuit by closing a contact in the closed circuit. Okay. When the breaker closes, pick up the Y relay so that it cannot close a second time. And once things have settled in, the breaker will end up closed. These two A contacts will be closed. In the green light circuit, that B contact would be open, and you can now trip the breaker through this circuit here with a control switch to trip the breaker, or a protective relay will trip the breaker. The only thing about this circuit is right here, the trip circuit, is it is burning the red light, or the red light's burning through the trip coil, monitoring the trip coil. You don't want to have a breaker close that you can't trip. That's what they're doing with the red light, monitoring the trip circuit. Make sure that the trip circuit is good. If that red light is out, find out why. because it could be an open trip coil, could be an open contact in the trip circuit. Very important. A lot of folks aren't aware of that. These are spares here for other purposes, position of the breaker. These are options, an under voltage relay to monitor the bus voltage perhaps, and another shunt trip coil number two. Trip coil, there's shunt trip coil number one over here. That's another option. So once you can understand mechanically how a breaker works, then move to the electrical side of it. Go slow, work your way through each circuit. The motor, it's separate from the closed circuit, and that's separate from the trip. So work your way through, use the manufacturer's information, and just keep digging at it, and eventually you'll get there to where it will make more sense. Okay, I think that's where we'll stop today.
All right. Thank you, Dean. At this time, the presentation portion of the webinar is officially concluded. We will now take 30 minutes to answer as many of your questions as possible. If you have any questions that you haven't already submitted, please submit them now into the Q&A box, and we will get to those as many of those as we can in the next 30 minutes. For those that are leaving, when you close the webinar window, a survey should pop up on the screen. We would greatly appreciate it if you could take a couple minutes to provide your feedback so that we can continue to improve upon future webinars. On that survey, there's a field where you can enter in notes or any kind of requests for quote or additional information that you have. If you have questions about anything else, please, you can ask them there as well. And we'll get to those in the following weeks. Also, a copy of the presentation, along with a link to the video recording of the webinar, will be emailed to everyone within about 2 to 3 business days. So be on the lookout for that. You should receive that next Monday or Tuesday. All right, now let's go ahead and get to some of your questions.
Okay, there we go.
Okay, first question was from Kamal. What are the risks involved in simply opening the door to view the breaker's nameplate? And then part two, are the risks lesser in magnitude relative to racking the breaker in and out?
Yeah, anytime you open the door, obviously you're exposing yourself to energized components or possibly energized components. It depends on the state of the breaker. Is the breaker closed, carrying load, or is the breaker open and locked out, tagged out? The only reason for me to be in looking in the cabinet possibly would be to look for information off of a nameplate or looking at information on a particular component. You're not necessarily at any higher risk. You're just closer to the source if something does happen. It's like walking through the switch house with a clipboard. You know, I'm not doing anything. I'm not disturbing anything. But when I open the door, I am now putting myself in a more dangerous position that if something does happen. But look at the breaker, look at what the circumstances are, look and see if it's carrying load, is it de-energized or energized, and I think that will help guide you. But anytime that you are introducing anything into that area, if you're doing grounding, if you're doing voltage testing, if you're doing something with a voltage tester. That's when you're at most risk, is when you're actually doing something inside that area. Just looking, I don't see a big risk in that.
Okay, thank you, Dean. Next question, Dan asked, how would we know if we had a spring failure, especially between maintenance cycles?
You probably wouldn't. You probably wouldn't unless the spring target showed that it was discharged and once the spring did break. But some of those indicators can be not necessarily that accurate, and I'll say accurate, but not necessarily forgiving. If the spring did break, something happened, that doesn't necessarily mean that the indicator is going to go to discharge unless, it actually lets that target fall back into the discharge position. So that would be the thing. If the indicator showed that it was discharged, because the spring broke, then that would be the only indication I have. Otherwise, that spring could be, you know, laying in the top of the ceiling somewhere, and I wouldn't know it just by looking at the breaker until I got ready to operate the breaker itself. So that's a tricky one. You probably wouldn't know unless the indicator gave you an indication of that.
All right. Next question was from Josh. Is there a requirement for manufacturers to provide a means to physically disable closed spring charging for purposes of LOTO other than simply disconnecting the spring charge motor power source?
No. I mean, there are folks that will do switching, racking in a breaker and as part of their procedure. They may not pull fuses or open up knife switches while they're doing their lockout, tagout. To me, it's the best policy is before you start doing racking of the breaker, racking it in or out, is to disable the control power. But some people want to use that control power so that they can tell when they're in the test position. As you rack the breaker in, as soon as you reach test position, the motor starts running. And so you know you're in the test position. Some people like to leave the fuses in for that reason. But as far as I know, there's no way that there's nothing that the manufacturers is responsible for in that realm.
All right. Next question was from Juan. This PS1 and 2 and Y relay design, is that standard on Westinghouse? Is it also on Eaton?
Yeah, I've never seen anybody else do energize the Y relay as a means of opening up the closed circuit. There's many manufacturers that will put interlocks on the floor that will open up the control circuit, and sometimes even that same roller, not only does it operate a contact electrically, it will also move the latch. It'll move the trip latch out of position so that the breaker's trip free. The print can't show that. You don't see that on a print. All you know is there's some sort of contact that opens up the circuit. Sometimes you have to go hunt for it. But as far as putting rollers on the floor, yeah, there's several manufacturers do that. As far as opening up the Y relay circuit, that's kind of a unique situation.
All right. Thank you, Dean. Next question was from Larry. Please clarify on the control schematic, a contact open when breaker is open, or A, contact open when breaker is open, and then B, contact is closed when breaker open. The AA and BB contacts are open or closed when the spring is charged?
Yes. Well, yeah. Okay, an A contact, a lot of times people just say, okay, an A contact is a normally open contact. A B contact is a normally closed contact, meaning that when the devices are de-energized, when they're in the relaxed state, shelf state, right out of the box, if you were to look at the device, any open contacts would be for some considered an A contact. Closed contacts would be a B contact. So if the spring is discharged, that would be its relaxed shelf state, then the A contacts would be considered to be open, B contacts closed. They identify them as double A and double B, but since they're associated with a different device, different location, you certainly wouldn't call it an A and a B contact when it's associated with the spring charging. So you'll see that in other breakers where they use double A, double B, simply because they're in a different location or operate off a different device. Think of them as normally open and normally closed in the relaxed state. That might help you out.
All right, next question was from Muhammad. Please explain the purpose of the anti-pumping relay.
Okay, the anti-pumping relay, and I know I went through that pretty quick, is to prevent the breaker from closing the second time. For any time you energize the breaker, you want it to close only once. And the reason for that is if you close the breaker into a fault. If you're closing the breaker right outside the substation, you got a backhoe that dug into the cable, you're closing the breaker into a fault. You don't want to close it the second time. Then you're looking at a catastrophe, perhaps a disaster, because the breaker may not withstand that much fault current. You're standing in front of the breaker. It's simply a way to allow the breaker to close only once for each closed signal.
All right. Next question. Could you explain on where the chicken switch triggers on the DC control schematic if one were to be used in a high IE case?
Okay, I'm somewhat familiar with the chicken switch. If you operated a breaker with the chicken switch, it's simply taking the place of your right hand. So the chicken switch would actually close the contact labeled CS over C, which is the control switch to close, or it would be operating CS over T, which is the contact, the control switch contact to trip the breaker. So it's really just an extension of your right arm turning the control switch from a distance, and that's to obviously for safety purposes.
All right. Next question was from Ryan. Are there any resources for calibration of thermal magnetic overloads?
Are there any resources for calibrating thermal magnetic overloads? Yes. Yeah, there's all kinds of AB4, which is a NEMA testing standard, and also EPRI. If you go to their website, they did a lot of research into testing thermal overloads on breakers due to ambient temperature, due to testing phases too soon between tests. You don't allow the breaker to cool down. Does it really hit the curve or not hit the curve? EPRI did a lot of study in that realm. It ties you back to AB4. Between those two documents, I think you'll learn more than you ever want to know about breakers, thermal magnetic breakers.
Thanks, Dean. Next question. Rebecca asked, not sure if this is too big of a question or if it needs to be answered offline, but she's looking to replace a molded case circuit breaker, and it sounds like she needs to get one with a different frame size. Is there any advice on that?
Well, one frame size can fit many size breakers, like a 100-amp frame. Physically, that breaker is no bigger than a 70-amp breaker. The manufacturer will simply put different thermal elements in the same size breaker. Now, if you're talking about just adjusting the current rating on the breaker, a lot of them can be adjusted up or down with a dial that will allow you like 15% up or down. But as long as you're not changing the physical size of the breaker, which covers, like I said, a wide range for a particular size breaker is 70 to 100 amps, for example, that's where I would first start looking would be the physical size. If that's the case, then it's going to be a design issue.
All right. Thank you. Next question was from Ruben. Not sure if you have an animation that shows the shaft movement while charging the spring and while closing spring is operated, and also the trip latch position. Did you have anything on that?
No, I wish I did. I've taken every manufacturer that I find their instruction book, and I try to lay those drawings on top of each other, and then play them one at a time on top of each other, which gives me the feeling that the mechanism is moving. But only for the contacts open and closing. I haven't really found a way to, and I know there's people out there that can do this artwork a lot better than I can. I don't have the software that can show a mechanism turning and actually charging the spring, the motor turning, and so forth. And I'd like to challenge you to do that and send me a copy of it. It'd be quite an undertaking.
All right. Next question. Joseph asks, what have been typical failures for these types of switches? Limit switch, vibration, racking in and out?
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. Normally around here, it's going to be contamination. We even get fire ants that get into these small limit switches. Keep in mind, they're cheap. They're single break contacts. They're the C-form contacts. Ants love to get, they love that 60 cycle hum. I don't know why. They'll get in and pile on top of it. The actuator on a limit switch can get bent. The DHP, for example, has a very long actuator on the latch check switch, and it's very easy to bend it. That will cause a problem. But I would say contamination in the limit switches is probably the number one cause. Misadjustment or bending would be the second reason for them failing.
All right. Next question was from Martin. What PPE do you recommend when racking and unracking 750 VDC breakers?
That I would have to defer to the safety instructor. I'm not that well versed on the PPE. I wish I had an answer for you. I'd put on all I could stand, probably, but no, that's a silly answer. The arc flash analysis, if y'all haven't had that done, that's another service that AVO does, the engineering group doing the arc flash study. That's going to be my guide for how much PPE I'm going to have to wear, because different points in the system has different arc flash boundaries, and I just really can't answer that one part. Sorry.
All right, next question. If you have a voltage drop due to the length of the control cable, at what voltage would the anti-pump relay fall out?
Oh, well, the manufacturer knows, I would say plus or minus 15% of the nameplate voltage. So if it's 115-volt coil, then, you're looking at around 100 volts. But the manufacturer can give specific voltages at which that coil should operate, should stay picked up. But I would go with 15% if I didn't know, if I didn't have any other information.
All right. Gabriel asked, in the development of the DC schematics, what are the major pieces of equipment that you're looking for to make sure the schematics are showing all the correct pieces of equipment?
Okay, yeah. The if you look at a basic breaker control diagram, you've got to have the four components that do the work, the trip coil, closed coil, anti-pump relay, and the motor. From there, it varies quite a bit. It takes two B contacts and an A contact, limit switch on the motor, Y relay contact. In other words, if you look at the very basic trip and close circuit, the breaker, I think you'll be able to piece that together. But there's certain components that you have to have. I can send you that in a list if you need me to. But if you compare breakers, I think you'll be able to answer that question for yourself.
All right. Next question is from John. Do most breakers have a mode switch for trip free or non-trip free?
No. No, trip free is built into the breakers so that any time the breaker's closing, here's the gist of it all. Anytime the breaker receives a closed signal, a trip signal or trip function would always override the closed function. So it's not something that where you can turn it on, turn it off, or have a mode switch on, something like that. It's going to be there whether you like it or not.
All right. Next question was from Joseph. Is there a means for installing safety grounds while servicing?
Oh, certainly, yeah. And that depends on how much of the switch gear you've got out of service. You may be de-energizing the whole substation and you'll ground it at the transformer. Now, if you're talking about just grounding one breaker by opening up shutters and that sort of thing, you've got to have the line and the load side de-energized. That in itself is probably not a safe thing to do, but if you're de-energizing the entire switch gear, then I'll be grounding back at the transformer. That's where I would ground.
All right. Next question is from Ryan. When performing primary injection testing, how important is it to have the cover on? For example, Square D Masterpack NW16H1, replacing the MicroLogic 6.0 and leaving the cover off to continue the primary injection.
It wouldn't make a bit of difference, especially if it's solid state. If you're talking about heat and then generating heat, I wouldn't see any difference in with the cover on or cover off. If it's microprocessor, the heat's not going to, the current's not going to affect them anyway. So with covers off, I think you'd be perfectly okay to test them that way.
All right. Next question was from Juan. Is PS1 or 2 the same as TOC?
No. TOC is a truck-operated cell switch that's mounted outside the breaker, up above the breaker. It's not even in the breaker itself. It's in the cabinet that operates as the truck moves in between tests and connected. It rolls another set of contacts on a drum switch by the physical movement of the breaker sliding in and out of the cell. They call that the truck. So that PS1 and PS2, those are operate off the bottom of the breaker for safety purposes to simply operate as you go between test and connected. So and a sales switch would be called 52H or 52S for MOC or TOC.
All right. Thank you, Dean. Next question is from Jacob. Does the same schematic apply to ITE K1600 breakers as well? Not sure which one he's talking about, but I've noticed that he's noticed a lot more mechanical movements in the ITE breakers.
ITE is a very compact, very difficult to get your hands in and see much going on about. They do use a trip latch and a roller for keeping the breaker closed, and they're not using a cam from what I can remember. They're not using a closing cam, but they do use the closing spring. So it'd be significantly different. This one would be more like the DS breaker. ITE has got a few more moving parts, but the theory is the same.
All right. Next question was from Jorge. What are the minimum recommended maintenance for breakers that are not in service for a long time? Example, spare breaker units in a warehouse.
Okay. Yeah. The main thing is take care of them. Keep them wrapped up. Don't put them in the put them in the back behind the shop somewhere on the pallets. Let them get wet. Keep them wrapped up. Keep the climate controlled. Otherwise, I'm probably just going to exercise them maybe every 2 or 3 years, just operate them, see, and work them that way. But I'm not going to do any maintenance or testing until they go back into service.
All right, next question was from Rob. What is a good lubricating grease to use?
Rob, I got an easy answer for that. The best lubricating grease to use is whatever the manufacturer says to use. But Mobil 28 is probably my second choice. The no oxide grade A special from Sam Kim is probably my number one choice because it comes in a can rather than a tube, and it doesn't get all over your tools when the tube busts.
All right. Next question is from Nicholas. We have square D medium voltage breakers that should clear open in 3 cycles. These breakers have shown that they hang up for long periods than specified. How can we make sure these breakers clear properly between maintenance cycles?
Well, the only thing you can do there, Nicholas, is to when you take the breaker out of service, is to install some means to monitor the breaker. They have these the next trip devices or that you can buy. From various vendors, which means I'm going to go in before I take the breaker out of service. I'm going to go in and hook up this device. It's going to tell me the trip coil voltage, the trip coil current, and how fast the breaker operated. That's going to let me know what the breaker is doing at the time that I take it out of service, not after I've maintained it. And it'll either say you're doing a good job or you need to do more maintenance, one or the other.
All right, next question was from Syed. What is the difference between molded and non-molded circuit breakers?
So if you're talking about air power circuit breakers, they're built in molded case, or maybe you're talking about molded and insulated case. Those three categories, molded case, insulated case, and air power circuit breakers are typically built to the same standard, according to ANSI. The differences are to what level are you going to be able to open them up and do any maintenance or testing. Molded case, you don't open them up. Insulated case, you can open them up for inspection and for changing out components. And the air power breakers are made to maintain, made to take apart, made to rebuild, and they're the most the one that you can do the most maintenance on.
All right. And also, Vladimir asked, I think when your drawing went out early, he was wondering the part about when you're going through the A and B contacts that are mechanically connected via the drum. He's going to see if you could kind of go back over that briefly.
Okay. Yes. Okay. If you can imagine a rotating drum that has multiple contacts in it, sort of like a good example of it. It's stacked contacts that are stacked. It has a shaft that can rotate those contacts. Every other one of them would be open, as well as every other contact would be closed. All I have to do to operate those contacts is rotate that drum. I'm going to let the breaker rotate the drum by way of its mechanism. The mechanism is connected to that drum, And every time the breaker contacts move, the drum rolls. It goes back and forth, okay? And so the drum with the contacts inside of it are either going to follow the breaker, open when it's open, close when it closes. That would be an A contact. B contacts are just the opposite. They are going to be open when the breaker is closed, closed when the breaker is open. And by the way, you can even adjust them to where they would be all A contacts or all B contacts. You can adjust them accordingly. So just imagine a drum that rotates and contacts that are alternately A and B contacts.
All right. Thank you, Dean. Looks like we're out of questions. If you think of anything else or want to submit other questions, please feel free to contact us offline, or you can just submit that question on the survey. I just want to thank everybody for attending today. Please remember to fill out that survey. We'd really appreciate it. Thank you all again, and have a great weekend, everybody.